everyone, we're filling up fast. So if there's a space between you and the person next to you, just try to... Great. As soon as everyone's in their seats, we're going to turn off the lights so we don't want anyone tripping or falling. Head in.
Carnegie scientists explore the outermost reaches of space, the mysterious depths of the Earth, and the origins and mechanisms of life. Our brilliant and dynamic teams of scientists transform the landscape of discovery with their unbridled passion, insatiable curiosity, and never-ending quest for knowledge. With limited teaching, administrative, and grant pressures, Carnegie scientists concentrate on research and are empowered to go their own way. Our scientists are chosen for unique skills and boldness. Their amazing discoveries, spanning more than a century, demonstrate the power of freedom. Carnegie investigators are intrepid adventurers who pursue their goals even as they mentor and train the next generation of scientists. They are free, free to question, to wonder, to creatively pursue ideas from the vast universe to the subatomic world. Our scientists redefine the pursuit of what's possible for us, our planet, our universe. We explore the past to understand the present and inform the future.
Hi, I'm Matthew Scott. I'm president of the Carnegie Institution for Science, and I'm here by video because I have to be at meetings in California, so I thought I'd send this quick video note to welcome Dr. Ostrander to Carnegie for her talk. As may be obvious from my neighbors here, I would love to be there to hear the stories that she will tell, especially about how humans have shaped the evolution of dogs. But I like to think about crossing the Bering Strait, where humans probably survived much better if they treated their dogs well. And I think at that time, very likely, would you like another one? Very likely, the dogs were shaping selection of the humans. Anyway, she'll tell you all about it. I wish I could be there. Have a great time.
Light up here. Okay, thank you. So welcome to the Carnegie. My name is Marnie Halpern and I'm filling in for the president, Matt Scott, tonight. And I'm a scientist in the Department of Embryology in Baltimore. And it's a real pleasure to be able to introduce tonight's speaker, who's actually a good friend of mine. So anyone who has watched videos of extreme sheep herding by border collies knows how precisely dogs can respond to commands, better than children, actually. Dogs are also remarkable in many other ways. We've all heard the stories of dogs who can predict seizures and who can smell diabetes or cancer. There are lost dogs who have traveled hundreds of miles to reunite with their families, and dogs who can run 1,000 miles in a race. These are extraordinary feats involving innate canine capabilities that humans do not have. What human could be trained to smell a bed bug or detect marijuana hidden in a gasoline tank? Yet, for all their differences, dogs have a great deal, thank you for the light, by the way. Yet, for all their differences, dogs have a great deal to tell us about ourselves. The same strict breeding programs that give us our purebred canine companions also help scientists understand the hereditary basis not only of canine diversity and behavior, but of mechanisms of disease, such as epilepsy and cancer, that plague both dogs and humans. Our guest tonight, Elaine Ostrander, has championed the dog as a model organism for decades. She was a major force behind the complete sequencing of the canine genome in 2005, and she and her colleagues were the first to map genes for canine epilepsy, Addison's disease, and several cancers. At the same time, her research group has made major contributions to our understanding of canine evolution, revealing how changes in just a handful of genes produce enormous differences in dog size and body shape. And I forgot to mention, for those of you who are on the Carnegie Facebook page, you can see a picture of my dog there tonight. And my dog Jordan, who is a cockapoo. And the Ostrander lab has also taught us how dogs have curly hair or straight hair. It's remarkable what you can learn from them.
So she's a scientist with true Renaissance leanings. She also studies prostate cancer, the most commonly diagnosed cancer in the United States. Dr. Ostrander is the chief of the Cancer Genetics and Comparative Genomics branch at the National Human Genome Research Institute at the National Institutes of Health, just up the street. She developed her passion for dog genetics while working at the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory shortly after earning her PhD from the University of Oregon. She continued to develop the field at the Fred Hutchinson Cancer Research Center and the University of Washington at Seattle, where she spent 12 years before moving to the NIH in 2004. She is the author of nearly 300 papers, a fellow of the American Association for the Advancement of Science, and a recipient of many awards, including the Burroughs Wellcome Fund Innovation Award, the 2013 Genetics Society of America Medal, and Lifetime Achievement Awards for both her prostate cancer and her canine genetics research. The title of a recent paper by Dr. Ostrander succinctly summarizes her pioneering work with dogs. The title is Man's Best Friend Becomes Biology's Best in Show. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Ostrander.
Thank you. Ah, that's quite an introduction to live up to. Well, first of all, thank you all for coming, especially on such a stormy night. It's very, very poignant for me to be giving this lecture here at the Carnegie. I'm the daughter of a librarian, and there you go. And you know, when I was in third grade, we were told to write our very first term paper on a famous person. And so a third of the class picked Abe Lincoln, a third picked George Washington, and I think a third picked Joe Namath. But I wrote mine on Andrew Carnegie. I mean, that just seemed like what you would do. And at my house, it was perfectly normal to sit around and argue whether books should be shelved by the Dewey Decimal System, which is what my dad wanted, or alphabetically by last author, which is what I wanted. As it is today, to talk about, well, how fast is my stuff gonna get sent here by Amazon Prime? I've been waiting for 20 minutes, right? If you could pop up the first slide. This is my father, and he died about 2 years ago. And he was a librarian for almost 50 years. And on the next slide is a picture of the Summit View Ostrander Public Library, which was named after him shortly before he died. And nobody could be more proud of that than I am. So I want to dedicate tonight's lecture to my dad and to all the librarians who have come since Andrew Carnegie, because it's really because of them that I know how to read. So we'll go ahead and we'll charge in from there. All right, dog genes tell surprising tales, and we're going to talk about some of those tales today. So I am at the National Human Genome Research Institute, and part of my lab works on prostate cancer, and I could just as easily be standing here and talking about prostate cancer in humans, by the way, not dogs, as I am talking about dogs. But the dog work is probably what we're best known for, and so that's what we're going to dig in on today. So I want you to know that everything we do is a partnership with the general public. We are in a long-term partnership with dog owners, with dog breeders, with dog lovers, with veterinarians. We collect and we bank DNA from all the US breeds, as well as many of the international breeds. The American Kennel Club currently recognizes around 189 breeds, and each breed is a closed population. And that's going to become important as we talk. So there are over 400 breeds that are recognized worldwide. And one of the things our lab aims to do is to integrate each of their stories into the much, much bigger picture of how man's best friend came to be around the world today and how they came, in fact, to be man's best friend. So these are actually some of my favorite breeds. it's really important to understand about closed breeding populations. So all dog breeds are members of the same species, Canis familiaris, right? Even though these look very different, these different breeds, all members of the same species, all have the same chromosome organization, same genes, same everything. Despite that, we see that breeds display extraordinary amounts of morphologic variation, and that's really at the heart of the Dog Genome Project. Why is it that this breed has long legs, and this one has short legs, and this has a pushed-in face, and this beautiful golden retriever has an elongated nose, and this guy over here has these mustaches and eyebrows? What accounts for that? That's the question I want to be able to answer in my career. Breeds are genetically isolated, so in order to be an AKC-registered golden retriever, your parents had to be AKC-registered golden retrievers, and your grandparents, and great-grandparents, and so on. So what that means is dogs offer an enormous advantage in terms of doing basic genetics. So if I was going to study a complex disease like epilepsy, and 200 patients walked into my office with epilepsy, well, they probably each got it for some different reason. And there may be 200 reasons dogs get epilepsy, but within any single breed, there's going to be a very limited number of reasons. And so that's one of the reasons that, in addition to morphology and behavior, we really like to study disease susceptibility in dogs as well. So this is, for me, our wheel of life. So this is made by Bridget von Holt, who was then a graduate student with Bob Wayne and I. She's now an independent faculty member at Princeton. And so what we did is we took DNA samples from 1,000 different dogs, representing, at this point in time, about 85 breeds. And then we interrogated their genome at about 170,000 different positions. And we used that data to put together what's called a dendrogram. And this tells us basically how different dog breeds relate one to another. And I know these are hard to read, but a lot of it makes sense, right? So here's the boxer, and that's closely related to the bull terrier, the French bulldog, the miniature bull terrier, the Staffordshire bull terrier, and so on. And over here we have the greyhound, the whippet, the Italian greyhound, the Irish wolfhound, the Scottish deerhound, and so on. So you can immediately visualize how studying disease genetics in dogs works really well. So if I'm studying my epilepsy story over here in the boxer group, well, these dogs probably all got it because of a mutation they got from some common ancestor back here. And it's going to be a different story in the sighthounds. They have it, and they probably got it from some ancestral mutation they got back here. It's going to be different than what's going on between these two. This will be different than this. This will be different than that. But now that I know what breeds are related one to another, and I'm ever expanding that story, I have a great way to try and tackle these otherwise extraordinary complex problems of diseases we care about in human health and human biology, but in veterinary genetics as well. All right, so dogs and humans share genetic and genome features as well as recent advances. So dogs and humans share a lot of the same medical concerns. There's a lot of similarity in terms of disease risk, how the disease presents, what the underlying pathology is, as well as how they respond to treatment. Dogs and humans also share a lot at the genetic level. So remember, the chromosomes are organized in a pretty similar way. The gene order is the same. And my lab has spent a lot of time building maps with street signs that help us navigate around the dog genome, much as a city map helps you navigate around the city. So the other thing, because we're at the National Institutes of Health, we're very committed to doing things on a large scale and then putting those resources out for anyone in the companion animal or mammalian genome community who wants to use them. Over 100 different dogs have undergone whole genome sequencing at this point in time, and we have taken that data and we have cataloged it, and we've made an extraordinary database that people can now use to study their particular problem or their favorite breed. We've been very successful at finding disease genes, and I'm going to tell you a couple of those stories. There's a lot of work in cancer, in autoimmune disease, and in neurologic conditions in dogs because we can relate to very, very similar conditions in humans. And when we find a disease gene in dogs, I can guarantee you it's going to be important in the corresponding disease in humans as well. And we'll just go through a couple of good examples. Here are the top 10 diseases that you find in dogs. And you should recognize all of these except probably bloat, which is a torsion or twisting of the intestines, because they're pretty close to the top 10 of what we care about in human health and human biology as well. And just like in humans, dogs, cancer is at the top of the list. One in three dogs will get cancer at some point in their life. And there are some really extraordinary breed-specific examples. For instance, Bernese Mountain dogs, where 25% of those dogs will die of one particular cancer, histiocytic sarcoma. So some wonderful opportunities to unravel disease genetics in dogs. We're going to talk about cancer. So lots of breeds have specific risk for, have elevated risk for specific cancers. So for instance, we see a lot of osteosarcoma in Scottish deerhounds, in Irish wolfhounds, in Great Danes, and in Rottweilers. We see bladder cancer in the Scottish and in the West Highland White Terriers, as well as in the Shelties or Shetland Sheepdogs. Malignant histiocytosis, or histiocytic sarcoma, as it's more correctly called, we see that in the Bernese Mountain Dogs and in the Flat-Footed Retrievers. And gastric cancer, something that occurs in the Belgian breeds, and it also occurs in the Chow Chow. We want to understand why these breeds predispose to these particular cancers, because we know those genes are going to unlock some of the secrets of human cancer susceptibility as well. Deerhounds, Scotties, Bernese Mountain Dogs, and Chow Chows, some of the most beautiful breeds there are, and yet they're affected with these very significant rates of cancer. All right, so my first story, canine hereditary multifocal renal cyst adenocarcinoma and nodular dermatofibromatosis, or RCND, as we like to call it, or rock candy, as the graduate students used to call it. So this is an autosomal dominant form of kidney cancer. Early diagnosis is by observation of these microscopic renal cysts. You see lung cysts, you see pneumothorax, and the risk for kidney cancer really goes up about sevenfold for renal cell carcinoma tumors, and we see this pretty exclusively in the German Shepherd. So the reason I got interested in this particular cancer is a young woman from Norway who was a veterinarian came to me, and she said, you know, this dog came into my clinic, and it has this disease, and that was this dog here. He's a male. He's colored in black because he's affected. Circles are females. And she said, I have DNA from him, and I just got into a PhD program. And for my PhD, I'd really like to figure out what's causing this disease. And I said, well, do you have samples from anybody but him? And she said, well, he's kind of gotten over the fence a few times. And so he's been with this lady. And they had these kids, this lady and these, this lady and these, this and this, this and this, this and that. Okay, you get the picture, right? And so she genotyped all of these, and she was able to very quickly identify that the disease gene was on chromosome 5, but by looking at the pattern of markers or a variation along the chromosome, she was able to narrow down exactly where the disease gene was. So the chromosome, we of course have two copies of every chromosome, and we do have chromosome 5 if we're a dog, and the mutation was on the chromosome I've colored here in black. So let's look at this guy here. He's not affected, colored in white, and the top of his chromosome 5 is black, and the bottom is white. So that automatically means that the top of the chromosome can't be where the disease gene is. And we get information from this individual. They're unaffected, but even more of their chromosome is black, and a smaller amount is white, and that narrows the disease gene down to here. And we go all the way through all of these individuals, and in fact, we were able to very quickly get down to what the disease gene was. And it turns out the disease gene is a folliculin, and the disease is caused by germline mutations in the folliculin gene. So folliculin is a tumor suppressor. Its normal job is to keep cancer from happening. And so if you mess that gene up, like other tumor suppressors, cancer is going to pop up. And it's in a, it turns out to be in a pretty well-known cancer pathway that lots of people study. Now, there's a similar disease in humans. It's called Bertog-Debye syndrome. And I'd like to point out that the location of the gene was found first in dogs and later in humans. So this is one place where, again, dogs were leading humans. All right, and so it turns out that these kinds of pedigrees, I'm not gonna say they show up in your lab all the time, but they are truly, and they're truly extraordinary when they do, but they absolutely do exist. In every case, a canine pedigree is gonna be better than a human pedigree. So these are a couple of pedigrees of prostate cancer families from our human prostate cancer studies. Again, affected individuals are colored in black. The ones in stars we have DNA from. The slashes are individuals who were deceased and we were unable to sample. And we consider these really good families in human genetics. Right? Nothing like what we can get in dog genetics. So studying common human cancers in dogs turns out to be a very, very powerful way to begin to unlock particularly susceptibility. Here's another one of my favorite stories, and this is a story about poodles, all right? And this is one of my most favorite poodle pictures. It was actually given to us by the owner, who's a very, very talented photographer. And this is a story about genetic susceptibility to squamous cell carcinoma of the digit. Okay, so squamous cell carcinoma of the digit, or of the, we would say, finger or nail bed, it's actually the most common form of squamous cell carcinoma in dogs. About 44% of squamous cell carcinoma in especially in the poodles, but in other dogs, actually occurs here in the nail bed. It is a locally very aggressive cancer, and it's pretty breed specific. So if you are a giant schnauzer, your chances of coming down with this are 22-fold greater than the average mixed breed dog walking down the street. That's huge, that's huge. If you are a Briard, your chances of getting this are about 10-fold higher than the average mixed breed dog walking down the street. And you are a standard poodle, it's about 6-fold. Now, we started getting calls from standard poodle owners telling us that their dogs had this. And of course, it's very debilitating for the dogs. The individual digits are removed. It affects multiple digits. It affects their quality of life. It's certainly a pain issue. It's basically a really, really difficult thing for both the dogs as well as the owners. But what was really striking is all of the calls we were getting were from owners whose standard poodles were black. We never got a call, and to this day have never gotten a call from an owner whose standard poodle has this was light colored. So we see it in the black dogs, we see it in the dark, dark, dark grays. We don't see it in the whites, we don't see it in the creams, we don't see it in any of those light colored standard poodles. So I thought, well, this is kind of interesting because whatever this gene is, it has to have something to do with cancer and it has to have something to do with coat color. And I wonder if selection for a particular coat color has piggybacked something deleterious. And you kind of expect that when you think about how dog breeds are developed. We know that humans have selected long and hard to create these breeds of a very specific appearance, of very specific metrics. So it would make sense that some bad stuff has come along at the same time. So Danielle Cariotti in my lab scanned the genome of affected standard poodles compared to unaffected standard poodles. And she landed in this particular region. And what you're looking at here is position in bases on a particular chromosome. And on the y-axis, you're looking at a measure of significance as minus the log of the p-value. And generally, if you're hitting above 7, you're looking at something that's significant. Now, every one of these dots is a different base pair along this chromosome that she looked at. And you can see, okay, this is almost certainly where the disease gene is gonna be because we've got a huge, huge signal here. And it turns out there's a great candidate gene underneath that signal, and it's the gene called KIT ligand. So this made really good sense because the gene is important in determining coat color. It helps make that inky jet black coat that's so prized in black standard poodles, really, really dark.
But it's also been associated with some forms of cancer. So we scanned the sequence of this gene. We looked at all the places in the dog genome that go into expressing this gene, and we couldn't find any mutation. And then Danielle cleverly said, well, the mutation's not in the actual gene, it's in something that affects ramping up or ramping the gene down. It's a regulatory mutation. And that's a reoccurring theme in a lot of things that I'll talk about today. And indeed, she was right. So here's the KIT ligand gene. And it turns out that there are these, there are about 300 base pair elements, and they're repeated multiple times. So these are called enhancers, and when these proteins bind to them, they ramp up production of the protein. Now, it turns out there's variation in how many of these binding sites you have. You can have 4, or you can have 3. Those are the most common variants. So if you got a 4 from mom and you got a 4 from dad, your KIT ligand expression is really high, and your disease risk turns out to be really high. If you got a 4 copies from mom and you got 3 copies from dad, or vice versa, you're a 4-3, well, KIT ligand expression is moderate, and your disease risk is moderate. If you're a 3-3, so you got only 3 copies on the chromosome from mom and 3 on the chromosome from dad, hey, your disease risk is 0. We have never seen a 3-3 dog who in fact had the disease. So now we've learned an awful lot. We've learned, first of all, that this well-known pathway of cancer, this is the BRAF gene, and these are other genes that are known to be important in cancer. The ones that are starred had been previously identified as important in cancer, and now we know, hey, it's time to add KIT ligand to this story as well, because this is also a cancer susceptibility gene. And because KIT ligand is involved in coat color, as is MC1R over here, and we understand how these two interact with one another via a gene called SARC, now we're able to start putting these two seemingly very different pathways together as we build our understanding of cancer susceptibility in this case. So this whole story started just because some dog owners called us and said, hey, my standard poodles are getting this, but it's only in my black standard poodles. And out of that, we're able to make a significant contribution not only to canine health, but to our understanding of human cancer biology as well. All right, so gotta talk about morphology, don't we? Really? Dogs, morphology, right? Okay, so anyone who's heard me talk has seen this picture before. This is a Harlequin Great Dane, and Dana Drager in my lab could tell you all the genes that go into making the dog have this particular coat pattern. And this down here is a Chihuahua, and skeletally, these dogs differ in size by 40-fold. That's extraordinary, and yet they are members of the same species. And people ask me all the time, could you cross them to get fertile offspring? I'd just like you to think that through before you do it. That's all I have to say. All right. So we've been studying lots of forms of variation in dogs. And I'm going to tell you a couple stories about body size, tell you about leg length. Jeff Schoenenbeck, who's now an independent faculty member at University of Edinburgh, has done beautiful studies on skull shape. Dana's been doing studies on bite. Edward Cadu, who's now at University of Rennes, did lots of studies on fur length, fur texture, and fur curl. So we're going to start by talking a little bit about body size, okay? So when we started this experiment, we knew we needed a really good data set on which to build our story. And we were very fortunate to have one. Now before I show you that data set, I have to introduce one concept. And this is the concept of identical by descent, or IBD. That's going to be important for tracking what goes on in this data set. So imagine a dog breed a long time ago. We picked the collie here. And it gets a mutation that unfortunately causes blindness. And there are several genes that do that in the standard collie. So the mutation occurs many, many, many generations ago. It's on an ancestral chromosome, and it leads to our disease, in this case, blindness. And now time passes, breeders are involved, they're selecting for different things, and now there's a handful of different breeds that were originally related to the collie but are now themselves their own breed. And we have pictures of all of those different breeds up here. They also, a subset of those dogs, have the same form of blindness. And it's because they carry the same mutation, as indicated by this little black star, as what was in the ancestral chromosome. So our ancestral chromosome was gold, lots of things getting crossed in, selected for, all kinds of things happen. And the dogs that are affected with the disease, well, they retain the mutation, that ancestral mutation, and they retain a little bit of that ancestral chromosome that came from the first collie. Now, in a perfect world, every dog, I could have the sequence of every single dog, but I can't. And so when I'm looking for a disease gene, I sequence, or I get sequence, from just the smattering of the dog chromosomes, or of the dog genome. And we get data from about 170,000 different points on the dog genome. And what we're looking for is, we're not probably going to be lucky enough to hit on that mutation in the 170,000 positions we look at, but we'll probably be able to find that orange or golden commonality. And when we do that with statistical significance, it tells us, aha, that's where the gene you're looking for is. And that's true for diseases, and it turns out it's true for morphology as well. All right, so let's talk about my data set. So many years ago at the University of Utah, there was a terrific plant geneticist named Gordon Lark. And he was one of these really old school geneticists, very rigorous, could do gazillions of genetic crosses and probabilities up there in his brain. Actually a little intimidating to me the first time I met him. But sitting in his office, Gordon had a Portuguese water dog named Georgie. And in the later years of his career, Gordon stopped working on plants and became so enamored of Georgie that he actually began a project which still goes on today at the University of Utah, and it's called the Georgie Project. And it's a study of Portuguese water dogs. So isn't tenure wonderful? Yes. Yeah, right. All right, so Gordon took got DNA samples from over 500 Portuguese water dogs, and he had a super collaborator, Kevin Chase, who did a lot of this work. And then from each of those dogs, he got 5 x-rays, and from those, a set of 92 different measurements or different metrics. So working with Gordon, Nate Sutter in my lab scanned the Portuguese water dog genome. Now, the reason we did this study of body size in Portuguese water dogs is because the American Kennel Club actually allows a lot of variation in body size in Portuguese water dogs. They're a working breed, carried on board ships, help haul in nets, do a lot of things, haul drunk sailors back onto the boat. They're very important in the industry. Okay, so these are small dogs, and the larger ones differ in size by almost twofold. And so Nate scanned the genome of large versus small Portuguese water dogs, and remember we said 7 was our magic number over here. I'm sorry, my pointer's not lighting up very much. But you can see that we have this really, really nice hit on this particular canine chromosome, and it's right here at about position 44.5. So this is where I'm looking here, and you can see we have lots and lots of dots telling us that there's something there that's important that differentiates big Portuguese water dogs and small Portuguese water dogs. So Nate went and collected DNA samples from lots and lots of different breeds, and he looked through their genome, and he looked for what we call a selective sweep. So what a selective sweep is a place in the genome that breeders have been selecting on and selecting on and selecting on in order to get a particular characteristic into breeds. Now, they don't know what the gene is. They don't care what the gene is. But what you find is that the variation in the genome plummets wherever that important gene is. So you're looking at measures of variation or heterozygosity, comparing small breeds to large breeds as you walk along this chromosome. And it's 1, as it should be, as you chug along until you get here when it plummets to 0. And then when you pass through this gene, which turns out to be IGF-1 or the insulin-like growth factor 1 gene, it shoots back up. And this is what you call the money shot. Because when Nate came into my office and showed me this, I knew IGF-1 is really important in distinguishing big dogs and little dogs. It's part of what's controlling that variation. Now, I'm only gonna show you one really annoying slide, and this one here, because if anyone's thinking about coming to my lab, this is what you spend most of your time arguing about at Tuesday morning lab meetings. So this is just a linear representation of IGF-1. Every one of these numbers is a place where there's variation in that particular gene. And then this A through J is telling you all the different combinations of variation that you can have. Now, I know in the back you can't read this, but what we're looking at over here is DNA from little dogs. So we're looking over here at the Pekingese, we're looking at the Yorkshire Terrier, the Pomeranian, the Chihuahua, any of those little things that you see movie stars carrying in their pockets and the tabloids, that's what we're looking at here, right? And so what's very striking about this is that even though there's a dozen possible combinations we could have seen in all of these dogs, we don't. In small dogs, overwhelmingly, we see this B pattern, or this B haplotype, as we would call it. So that was very, very striking. And it told us that IGF-1 was indeed very important in making small dogs small, but the mutations in the gene had occurred very early in domestication, because all of these small breeds who are scattered all around our wheel shared the exact same DNA sequence. So sometime after dogs were domesticated, before the great division into breeds, most of which occurred during Victorian times, the mutations happened, which were then propagated and selected on by breeders in order to make small breeds small. So we've gone on to identify other genes that contribute to body size, and they're listed for you down here. Now, the reason I wanted to show you this is because it's very, very different than what you would see if you were studying humans. So the color coding represents the frequency of a variant. Now, red is what we tend to see in modern times. It's what we would call the derived allele. And yellow is what we see when we looked in wolves. So that's something that's been around for thousands and thousands, tens and tens and tens of thousands of years. And this is weight in pounds. Now, when we look at really small dogs, they have this modern or red variant at all of these different genes. And as we get bigger and bigger and bigger in pounds, we tend to see more and more and more of the genetics of the wolf and less and less and less of what's come about only in these modern dog breeds. This is derived allele and this is ancestral allele. So we can actually explain most of the variation in body size in dogs up to about 80 pounds. Well, we can explain somewhere between 60 to 80%. So that's amazing. A dozen genes account for being anywhere from 0 to 2 pounds up to being about 80 pounds. That's amazing. In humans, the difference between being 5'6" and 6'6", that's about 180 genes. A reoccurring theme, small numbers of genes of large effect account for the extraordinary variation that we see in dog breeds. I do have to tell you, there is an outlier, as there is in every experiment. These are Rottweilers, and they do not fit my story well at all. And Josh Places went on and he identified 3 genes that make big dogs big. So we can actually now extend this. Previously, this particular set of genes only accounted for about 5% of making big dogs big, and they accounted for 60 to 80% of making the little dogs little. So Joss had a fair amount of work to do, and he can now, with his 3 new genes, he can account for both height in dogs, but he also found a gene that controls how wide their butt is, you know? Back fat gene, we call it. So we're pretty sure that one's gonna be interesting in human populations as well. What do I know? I'm just predicting, the paper just came out, what do I know? All right, So let's go and talk about another trait. This is maybe a little bit easier story, but I think it's just really very cool. So this is chondrodysplasia, and it's a breed-defining trait for about 20 different dog breeds. So you will probably recognize several of these. This is the Basset Hound, Dachshund. This is the Scottish Terrier. These dogs frequently do very well at dog shows. Dandy Dinmont Terrier is actually a very, very rare breed. So in order to be considered chondrodysplastic, you have a ratio of height to body length less than one. The skeleton of these dogs is considered heavy, or as breeders would like to say, well-boned. And the forelimbs are often bowed or curved or turned out, like you can see here in the Basset Hound. So Heidi Parker in my lab, who, by the way, has a dachshund and has a Basset Hound, by way of full disclosure, was very interested in finding out what it was that gave these dogs this disproportionality. And honestly, we didn't know what we were going to find. We thought maybe the different dog breeds, I actually thought that every one of them was going to have a different story. Other people in the lab were betting that they all shared a common mutation, like IGF-1, and other people thought, well, maybe subsets of them told a similar story. So we all bet, we're not allowed to bet money at NIH, so we bet a lot of M&Ms on this. And it turns out the people who thought there was going to be one mutation were the people who were right. So this is called a Manhattan plot. And what you're looking at is each one of the dog's chromosomes going from one all the way up. Here's the X chromosome. And I have to admit, we don't look at the Y because we figured there's probably nothing really important on the Y chromosome. All right. And then here, OK, look at this signal. Wow. We compared the genome of a bunch of control breeds, 64 of those, 702 individual dogs, to 95 dogs from 8 of these chondrodysplastic breeds. And we got this just huge, huge signal. So you never see p-values. This is a p-value of 10 to the negative 102 for the statistical people in the audience, right? Doesn't ever happen in human genetics. Gotta love dog genetics. This makes the prostate people drool, by the way. They go nuts when they see this. All right, and so it turns out that the mutation is really very interesting. It's not something that we knew was important in mammalian disease genetics before. This was the first example of it. So this is a retrogene, and it's fibroblast growth factor 4 retrogene. So in a retrogene, what happens is the coding parts of the gene have been zipped together really nicely, getting rid of all that regulatory stuff and in-between stuff. And then the gene picks up regulatory signals from whatever genes are around it, because it doesn't have any of its own. So you have the good copy of the gene expressed when it's supposed to be over here, and then millions and millions and millions of bases away you have this retrogene, and it's doing whatever the genes around it do. And that's what turns out to be happening here. So what you're looking at here is expression. You're looking at expression of both the normal gene and the retrogene. So these are non-chondrodysplastic breeds, and the normal gene is represented by these two bands here. And now here you're looking at chondrodysplastic breeds, and they have the two-band pattern, but they also have this big band pattern over here, telling us that both the normal gene and the retrogene are expressed in this story. So there's more to do, but we believe that overexpression of this gene, or else it's mistimed production, leads to early closure of growth plates in these chondrodysplastic breeds. So this is really very interesting. These dogs have no other health problems. They are actually quite long-lived, some of them. And so this was the first example of this way of messing up DNA to cause this kind of a phenotype that had been observed in mammalian genetics at the time. And it's since been observed in other situations as well. So that's why dogs have really short legs in some cases. Now, what was curious about this is Heidi came to me and she said, you know, look at this. Gosh, when I look at where these chondro breeds are, they're kind of all over the wheel. So again, this is going to be a pretty old mutation. And going back far enough, all of these breeds are going to have some relationship one to another. So that really made us think, you know, there's a lot that we really don't know about dog breeds per se. We know that dogs were domesticated. Their closest ancestor is the wolf. And people argue endlessly about how long ago that happened, 13,000 years ago, 30,000 years ago, 15,000 years ago. We do know it's an evolutionary, just barely a drop in the bucket. It's an incredibly short period of time. And we see all this variation in breeds because of humans, 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 humans. We have push dogs and bred them so that they are what we want them to be in order to meet our needs, hunting, herding, whatever it is that we needed. The intermediate canid, whatever it is not living on Earth today. We're pretty sure about that. But we don't know a lot about how most breeds came about. We don't know about hybridization. We don't know where different dog breeds migrated to or when most breeds were formed. So Heidi and Dana Drager undertook this super study to address that. So now you're looking at a much, 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 much more complete wheel. We have many, many more breeds on it. Now we have double the number. We have about 161 dog breeds, really representing places from all over the world. And again, we're putting together these really nice stories of who's related to who and where ancestral characteristics likely came from. So let's look at that a little bit closer. All right, so we talked about what a haplotype was. Haplotype was, all right. So we said it was a series of markers or variation in the DNA that's inherited generation to generation to generation. So we know what that is. And we talked about identical by descent. So those are markers that are shared between individuals because they're inherited from a common ancestor. And we know what haplotype sharing is. We also know that the longer a piece of DNA is that's identical between individuals or between breeds, the more recent is the relationship between those dogs or those breeds. Because the more time you have, the more recombination and jiggling and switching around goes on. Whereas if you have something that's very, very long that's shared between several breeds, they're going to be much more closely related than if the sharing is really very small. So in the previous slide, each one of these color codings are called clades, and they're statistically related groups of individuals. So if we look across clades, as we are doing right here, then what we find is that the amount of haplotype sharing is less than if we look within clades, which is less than if we look within a single breed. And that makes sense, right? Dogs of a breed will be more closely related, dogs of a clade will be more closely related, and at the very end will be dogs who represent different clades, right? Okay, so that makes sense. So this took 2 years to generate. You have to be impressed. It's framed and it hangs on my wall. All right. This tells you how every single dog breed was created. Because we have done that analysis, again led by Heidi Parker, for all of these different dog breeds. And what this is called a ribbon plot. And what the ribbons are telling you is who combined with who to make what. It's telling you how DNA got transferred and shifted all around these 161 breeds to create the breeds as we know them today. So this is a gold mine. I can use this to identify how traits got shared. I can even use it to figure out how different disease alleles got shared. And I can use it to figure out how different breeds were created hundreds of years ago. All right, so here's an example. So we're gonna look here at one of my favorite breeds. This is a Eurasier. This is just a lovely, lovely dog breed. Now, you're looking at a few clades, and every one of these columns is a different breed. I know you can't read the breed names down here, but the yellow are different breeds of one clade. The gray are different breeds that are, again, a clade, purple, blue, so on. So what I'm asking is what dog breeds went into making the Eurasier? And I see a signal in three places. I can't get this to work right now. I can see a signal in three places. I see a signal up here in yellow for the Chow Chow, one for the Samoyed, and one for the Kisan. So if you could read these dog names down here, those are the breeds that that this study is telling me went into making the erasure. Now, did the erasure go into making any of these breeds? No. So I look here at the Chow Chow. Well, it went into making the erasure, but the erasure did not go into making him. The Samoyed, again, Samoyed went into making erasure, but when you look at this, you can see that the erasure did not go into making the Samoyed. This is all a one-way street, and the case hound went into the erasure did not go into the case hound. So I can now say with a pretty high degree of confidence, by looking at that ribbon plot, who went into what to make what. And remember, a lot of breeds were created, especially during Victorian times, by mixing and matching different breeds. And after catastrophic world events like World War II, a lot of breeds had to be recreated. And I can now tell you from my ribbon plot exactly how that happened. And I can also tell you the time frame in which it happened. So I can plot how many years ago or how many generations ago, this is actually in years, big events happened. Okay, so in my world, a big event is when the Norfolk and the Norwich Terrier split. That was huge for me. And that happened about 40 years ago. The Chow Chow began the Eurasian development. Okay, that's gonna be here about 50 years ago. We had to recreate the Irish Wolfhound from the Scottish Deerhound in Europe following these catastrophic events about 80 years ago. The Silky Terrier, created from the Yorkie and the Australian Terrier. The German Shorthaired, the Wire-Haired Pointing Griffon, I know that's one that you all love. They went together to make the German Wire-Haired Pointer, which is absolutely a lovely, lovely breed. And then we can tell pretty complex stories, like the Bulldog, the French Bulldog, and the American Staffordshire came together to create the Boston Terrier about 150 years ago. So we have a genetic window. Because we have the genome sequence of these dog breeds, because we've been able to put together this ribbon plot, we can look at these dog breeds and we can tell what their genetic mosaic is. We can say, look, this is like 23andMe for dogs, really, right? Her ancestry.com or whatever those are. I can look at you and I can say, this is where you came from. And in doing so, I begin to understand why different dog breeds have particular diseases. So I think this is my last data slide. And I'm gonna give you one example. And this is the example of collie eye anomaly. And so it wasn't just by accident that I used the example of blindness when we were talking before about identity by descent. So this is a gene we actually mapped in my lab in a collaboration with Greg Ackland and Gus Aguirre at Penn and Cornell many, many years ago. It's found in border collies, Shetland sheepdogs, Australian shepherds. If you have the mutation, you're gonna get the disease. The penetrance is about 100%. So there's no wiggle room. If you have it, you're gonna get it. It's caused by a failure of cells in the back of the optical vesicles to express growth hormone. So what happens in the short version is you get retinal detachment and you get blindness. And you probably recognize that these are working dogs. And so having blindness going through working breeds, I mean, this is a very, very big deal to the breeders. So how did this happen, and where is the disease gene likely to pop up next? Well, let's look at our ribbon plot. So here are the collies, here are the Australian shepherds, the border collies, the Kelpies, and these are all herding dogs, and we can look how much they've intermingled back and forth and back and forth and back and forth over the years. So they've basically been giving whatever they have back and forth to each other. And that's clearly why it spread among these herding breeds. But recently, we've also seen it in this guy, which is a Nova Scotia duck tolling retriever. So is that unexpected? Well, it turns out it's not, because these three herding breeds over here have been crossed into this Nova Scotia duck tolling retriever. So they're part of what's gone into making up this Nova Scotia duck tolling retriever. So maybe that's not so surprising. But the really powerful thing about this is I can tell where things are likely to crop up next. So again, I can just follow the ribbons, okay? So this is taking me up here to the pug, and this is taking me up here to some of the terriers. But weirdly enough, it's also taking me to the Zolo and to the Peruvian Inca. So these are these little hairless breeds that you sometimes see in who's the ugliest dog contest. You know, they have little tufts of hair down here. And they are nothing like a herding dog at all. I mean, really nothing like. And anyone who's watching this online, I love these breeds. Please do not be offended. They're gorgeous, right? But you can see how this has gone into this. And so these are breeds that should probably be tested for this mutation as well. So what I've tried to show you is that genomics is incredibly powerful in any system. And we love dogs, we love all breeds of dogs, and we want to help make them stronger, we want to make them healthier. But we also want to help improve human health as well. And so the more we disentangle the origin of dog breeds, and the more we dig into morphology and these other traits in dogs, the more that we're able to do that. So how can you help? Well, there's lots of ways that you can help. These are some of the things that we study. And if you see something that you recognize, you definitely need to come up afterwards. So we have a big study on histiocytic sarcoma in Bernese Mountain Dogs and Flat-Coated Retrievers. For both of those breeds, about 25% of dogs will die of those diseases. Bladder cancer in Scotties, Westies, and Shelties. We had a recent paper on that with a test, actually. Gastric cancer in the Belgian breeds and the Chow Chow. So these are all breeds we're very interested in getting for cancer. We study lots of different traits. And so if you have any of these extraordinary, very big, very small, international breeds, anything out of the ordinary, please come and talk to us. We would love to enter your dog in the Dog Genome Project. And we're interested in dog history. So if you have a rare or unusual breed or combination of breeds, we would really like to talk to you. We would like to get more of these international breeds, giant breeds, and dogs that are historically considered, quote, ancient dogs that aren't necessarily recognized breed dogs. We would certainly like to get samples from them as well. So I'll go ahead and stop there. This is the contact information for Andrew Hogan in my lab, and he's the person you can email to find out everything you need to know about us. I went over. I'm sorry.
All right. Is this on? Okay. I would really like to thank Dr. Ostrander for a very compelling canine lecture. I don't know about you, but I'm going to go home and look at my dog tonight with a completely different set of eyes. So now we welcome you to the two microphones on either side. Those of you who'd like to ask her a few questions, please line up. And I'm sure she'll be willing to answer some questions.
Yeah, be happy to.
So do you have a way to test dogs before people choose to breed them so that the genes, genes don't get passed
on? So my own lab at NIH doesn't do that, but there are a number of commercial labs that offer several different tests. So I think the canine community has been very good about making data available as soon as we get it in terms of disease susceptibility. And if you go online, you'll see that there are lots of different tests that are offered by several different companies.
Okay, the other side.
So most of the dog breeding that you were talking about has happened in the last maybe 150 years,
yes.
It sounded like.
Yes.
And I'm wondering if you or anyone else has done studies or is doing studies that would help us understand the distribution of humans around the world based on the distribution of dogs around the world.
I love that question. So we have a large study going on, started in Sardinia with the Fonis dog, and it's now expanded to the entire Mediterranean. Mm-hmm. And what we've looked at is how those breeds came together to basically form each other and contribute to each other. And what we found is that where humans go, they take their dogs, basically. So human migration beautifully and dog migration beautifully parallels what we know about human migration. So we're now expanding those studies to try and fill in some of the gaps that we haven't been able to really understand about human migration. Mm-hmm. And so we have some really large studies, especially around the Mediterranean, that's addressing that. And I could give you a paper if you're interested.
And another aspect of that would be that it tells you maybe something about how complex the human society is if it came up with 10 or 100 different breeds of dogs somehow.
And how complex their needs were.
Other side here?
Yes. First, I'd like to say I I hope you're using some Y genes in your prostate.
I am. I was just kidding. I was just kidding.
Okay. But what interests me is the relatively short lifespan of the dog, considering the attachment of the human being to the dog. Now, has there been any attempts to breed length, you know, livability of the dogs? And have you looked at, is there anything in the genetic makeup that explains this relatively short lifespan?
So that's a great question. There have certainly been studies that are just taking off now, that have enough data to take off now, looking at genetics of longevity in dogs. And we know that smaller breeds tend to live longer, and those tend to be the companion breeds. And the larger breeds live shorter periods of time. So have people bred for longevity among the companion breeds? That's a great question, and I don't know the answer to that. But I do know that this inverse correlation's been noted many times, and we now have enough genome sequence that people are really digging in to try and answer that question. So we'll keep you posted.
Other side?
I apologize for not knowing, remembering all the details, but I believe in the early 20th century in Siberia, this gentleman bred foxes for docility.
Yep.
And supposedly that's the only trait that he bred for, and yet he says in his notes that he noticed physical changes in the foxes over time as well. And I was wondering if there was any correlation to
work. So this is the Novosibirsk study, and there were two principals. There's Ludmilla Trott, woman's also involved, I gotta say this here. And so this has been going on for a long time, and it was led by the furrier industry with silver foxes, who are very, very aggressive, to try and get them tame in the sense that humans could interact with them more easily. And after breeding several generations, they ended up with animals who were indeed more approachable, but they had these other characteristics that were reminiscent of dogs, white tip on the tail, sort of a barking-ish sound, and so on. So I'm happy to say that that whole study, the genetics and genomics of it, has been taken over by Anna Kukakova, who's worked on this in Novosibirsk, and she's now at Illinois. She started up her own lab in the last couple of years, and she has the fox genome sequence, and she is tackling that with those samples. So we can look forward to that.
Question?
I was wondering why dogs are able to evolve a lot faster than humans.
So why can dogs evolve faster than humans? That's a great question. And so people speculate, 30 years ago, or 20 years ago when I first started in this field, people said, well, is it that the wolf genome has all of this variation embedded in it, or is it there's something about dogs that their genome throws up mutations that breeders then select on much more frequently? And it's not that wolves have all this variation in them, we know that. We do know that there is a lot of mechanisms for creating mutations in dogs that creates mutations that are not very harmful, like merle coat color is due to one such mutation. So certainly there are mechanisms for that in the dog genome. But the real answer is human selection. We have selected very hard for the things that we want our dogs to do and to look like and to behave. And what studies really show is that it's that very strong crossing breeding that's really led to these wide variety of populations that we have today.
Yes, I'd like to know, for people who have who get a rescue dog and they send away for a DNA test, how accurate are those, you know, results?
Yeah.
Depends who does it.
You know, I honestly don't know for the different companies. If I did, NIH would tell me I can't comment on any product anyway. So it's just as well. I honestly don't know. The truth is almost all of our studies are done with purebred dogs because then we can get their pedigrees. And so the American Kennel Club has, you know, multi-generation pedigrees of every registered dog, and they have been very supportive of our studies and very willing to share with us. And so
that's a huge advantage to us, so I honestly don't know for mixed breed dogs.
Can you check a few more?
Sure, yeah.
Okay, just a few more. Go ahead.
We were trying to deal with allergies in our household with my sons, and we purchased an American Hairless Terrier.
Oh, I had a story about them and I took it out.
It's a great little dog.
Yeah.
But the question I had is, what is it about that breed that makes it more tolerable to people, and can we breed that to make other dogs more tolerant?
Yeah.
Or make us more tolerant to the dog, I guess. And then my other question also has to do with dog allergies. Why do dogs develop allergies?
So I don't know why dogs develop allergies. I mean, it's a big issue in dogs, and does it relate to historical inbreeding? Or I honestly don't know, but there are people who study it who could probably do a much better job of addressing it than I can. The breed you mentioned, the American Hairless Terrier, is the most recent or second most recent breed to be recognized by the American Kennel Club. And it came about in the 70s from the Rat Terrier. And we actually were able to trace its pedigree back to the original dog. And it's one of those just great breeds that came from a great breed. It's only been around for, you know, a short period of time, you know, 40 years or so. And so it retains all those endearing characteristics of that founder breed. People have worked hard to make sure it retains those behavioral qualities and family pet qualities, because a lot of its value was going to be as a family dog. And so it's a beautiful dog to look at. I don't have a picture of it here. And you're right, it's one of the hypoallergenic breeds that people are increasingly gravitating to. So I don't know how much effort there is to create other hairless breeds.
Is the creating the hairlessness part of it?
No. My understanding was that the hairlessness cropped up sporadically in a litter of the Rat Terriers in the 70s, and then it was, you know, selected until we have the breed as it is today. So I don't know what the thinking was behind the creating of the breed. I honestly don't know. Did they have, being a family, hypoallergenic in mind when they did this, or were there other reasons early breeders did this? I honestly don't know.
Okay, next question.
You found a bunch of mutations in IGF-1 and the receptor being related to size. Does that also predispose to cancer?
Oh, that's a good question. So IGF-1 does a lot of different things in the body, for sure, and it's involved in lots of different pathways, some of them important for sure in cancer. Do we have any mutations that specifically predispose or account for the cancer predisposition we see in any breeds? No, we don't.
Okay, last question.
Just thinking about behavior, I think we hear about breed bans and certain apartment buildings banning what they call dangerous breeds. Is there any basis for any of those conclusions in genetic research?
I think we'll move on now.
Okay, so first of all, I don't know. I'll start by saying that. There have been studies, early on people tried to do studies of aggression, and you know, they just didn't have the sample sets, they didn't have the genome sequence. I mean, it just wasn't there to do it. And so I think it kind of got a bad rap, and so it's really just now that people are coming back to revisit that question with these much more sophisticated tools. So people who are proponents of those breeds would say there are no bad dogs, there are just bad owners. People who have had the experience, of course, would really very strongly disagree. So, and that's completely, you know, that's completely understandable. So I think we're gonna have to wait and see how the genetics comes out. I think the first thing that's gonna come out are studies of really anomalous behavior, like obsessive compulsive disease. And that's gonna give the field credibility and a foothold in the study of these less desirable behaviors, right? And those things are ongoing now. And I think once those happen, and the field has some credibility in that sense, it can move on to these other traits. But it's obviously, as you know, a very sticky issue.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Before you leave, I just want to make a few important announcements for the Carnegie. First of all, I'd like to thank Margaret and Will Hurst for their generous support of tonight's program. Because of them, you'll be able to view tonight's lecture again and brush up on your genomics on Carnegie Science Facebook and YouTube accounts. In addition, I want to thank many of you, the individuals who donated when they registered for tonight's event. Many of you might not realize this, but Carnegie has been hosting these hour-long free lectures for the public for the past 27 years and will continue to do so indefinitely. We'd love to get your input on tonight's program and collect your ideas on future events and topics you'd like to see covered, but not cats right away, okay? Stay tuned for a survey in your inboxes tomorrow where you'll be given the opportunity to share your thoughts and ideas with the Carnegie. Tonight's lecture was the second out of five that make up the spring 2017 lineup. We have two more Capital Science evenings in May, one on May 8th with Dr. George Church from Harvard Medical School, and you can learn more about tinkering with the genome. And the second on May 31st with Carnegie Science's very own Diana Roman, who will speak about erupting volcanoes. Once again, I'd like you all to join me in thanking Elaine Ostrander for a wonderful dog-filled evening.
I'm so sorry. I had no idea I got so far over.
Okay. See you back in May. Thank you very much.